that's tired of worrying about what everybody else think and what's going on and just want to give it all up to the Lord in the presence of the Lord. If you're excited to be in the house this morning, just make some noise. Like, I am ready. I am ready for Jesus. I am ready to encounter the presence of the Holy One. Lord, we love you. And we thank you for this day.
Sometimes I come up here and like, they're still going. So, hey, welcome. Welcome. Great to have you here this morning at Grace Fellowship Church. Thank you for those who are watching online. You know, this song, Ain't No Rock, that comes from a scripture in the Bible where some very religious people were upset that some people were loudly and exuberantly praising Jesus. And they went to him and said, you need to rebuke your disciples. Have them tone it down a little bit. Have them stop praising so loudly and so exuberantly. And Jesus said, hey, if they stop, I can raise up some rocks to praise me. Now listen, the point is, all creation worships him. And the point is, God is going to be praised. The question is, are you going to get in on it or not? I mean, that's the question. And I encourage you this morning to press in and to worship him with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind, all your strength. Don't hold back. Don't hold back today. Enter in and worship him with all your heart. I'm Pastor Joe, and with your on-time call to worship, blessing, whatever it's going to be, this is Pastor Deb.
All right, how about just both? Be blessed this morning for being in the house of the Lord. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. So our blessing this morning, our call to worship is Psalms 57. I will praise you, O Lord, among the nations. Yes. I will sing of you among the people, for great is your love, reaching to the heavens. Your faithfulness reaches to the skies. Be exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let your glory be over all the earth. Do you ever stop and think about how blessed we are that we can stand here and exalt and worship and praise, lift our hands, lift our voices, dance, sing, shout, pray unto the God of the nations, unto our God Almighty. Father, we are so grateful and thankful that we can stand here in this house and worship you today. We give you all that we are. We give you all that we have, and we say unto you, O God, we love you, God. We bless you, God, and we thank you in the mighty name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. Can you say amen? All right, so come on, church. Let's worship.
Wandering into the night, wanting a place to hide this weary soul, this bad bone. And I tried with all my might, but I just can't win this fight. I'm slowly drifting, a bag of love. It's my story. Just when I ran out of the road, I met a man I didn't know, and he told me that I was not alone. Come on, sing.
You picked me up, you turned me around, you placed my feet on solid ground. I thank the Master, I thank the Savior, because he healed my heart, he changed my day. Forever free, I'm not the same. I thank the Master, I thank the Savior.
Come on, say.
I thank God.
Yeah. I cannot deny what I've seen. Got no choice but to believe. My doubts are burning, oh, like ashes in the wind. My own.
determined to walk away from my past. Anybody with me?
Yeah. Woo.
So long to my old friends.
Yeah.
My old friends with burden and bitterness. Anybody had them for friends? But I'm determined this morning to walk, because he found me in my weakness and said, I can do it, said, I can make it, said, I am free, said, I can run, said, I can dance, said, I am healed, said that I am touched, said that I am blessed, said that I can shout, said that I can speak like, said that I am healed, said. So I am gonna get up, get up, get up, come on, get up out of that grave, get up, get up, get up, I'm gonna get up out of that grave, get up, get up, get up, get up out of that grave, get up, get up, get up, I am determined to
get up, get up, get up.
Get up out of that grave.
because he healed my heart.
He changed my name. Forever free, I'm not the same. I thank the Master. I thank the Savior. I thank God.
Receive that freedom that's in the room. Breakthrough is right here.
Jesus.
Come on. Hey.
Bring one.
You have not flung open the doors. You have not sung the praise, but you have not moved out of the pit that Satan had you in into the glory of the Lord. So as we sing and as we praise, I want to encourage you to crawl out of the pit. You know, we can be set free and not find our freedom because we refuse to leave what's comfortable. And so sometimes we need to dance when it's not comfortable. We need to praise when it's not comfortable. We need to step out when it's not comfortable. Because the Lord says, I'm not leaving you where you were, but you need to step out. You need to not like your pit so much. Maybe it's a friendship you need to leave behind. Maybe it's just you're inhibited. Maybe it's a decision. Maybe it's a habit. But I'm telling you right now, you have been set free, but you have to step out and fling open the door and walk away from the pit.
That is so much confirmation. And stepping out is just not a mental thing. I need you guys to literally step out. This altar is open. The aisles are open. Step out. Dance. The Bible says that when Jesus said it was finished, you know, guys, it was really finished. And we have a legal right to the freedoms that he has given us. We have a legal right. So when it says dance upon the injustices, dance upon it. Dance and crush it. It is literally stomping the head of the enemy. This is your warfare. If you are sick in your body, you need to dance it out. If you are falling in lack, dance it out. Don't allow shame. Don't allow selfness, whatever it is that you have that is keeping you tied in those seats, tied in that area, that you can't even release your arms in worship. You can't let your feet dance. I'm asking you now, by the Spirit of God, break free. It's in your power to be free. It's in your power because the Spirit of God lives inside of you. It's in your power. If you are able to come to this altar, they're going to continue to sing. Let's dance on the head of the serpent. Let's dance on our enemies. Let's do this together. Because if you're not breaking shackles off of you, you're breaking it off of somebody else in here. Hallelujah.
The word said that if we are God's children, then we have overcome the world. And this is the victory that we have, our faith. So when we sing and when we dance, it is a faith. It's not because everything is perfect, but we serve a perfect God.
I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me all my days. I've been held in your hands from the moment that I wake up until I lay my head. I will sing of the goodness of God. Close like no other. I've known
Over my life, all my life you have been faithful, never missed a second of it. All my life you have been so good.
Every breath that I am in,
oh, every breath that you bless me with,
I will sing of goodness.
Didn't miss a second. Sing it again. Just sing out the goodness of God. What does it sound like? Fill the room with praise. Fill the room with praise and just tell him how good he is to you. Oh, we fill the room with praise, oh God. Oh, we fill the room with your praise, oh God. We can feel you chasing us, Jesus. We can feel your goodness running out. We can feel your goodness and mercy, oh, following us, oh God. Oh, 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 oh. In spite of every situation, we'll sing it. We'll sing of your goodness. We'll highlight your goodness. We'll amplify your goodness. We'll magnify your glory, Lord, because you are here, oh God. Oh, yes, we will. cry out to you, Lord. We just sing of your goodness, sing of your praises. Every breath that we have, every breath in our lungs, we'll sing of your goodness. Oh. I know it may be hard to dance. I know it may be hard to shout. But I want you to use your voice and just fill the room with praise. Come on, fill the room with a song of praise. Sing of your goodness. Come on, sing, God, you're so good. God,
you're so good.
Yeah. We'll sing it, oh.
God, you're so good.
Yes, you are. Yes, you are.
God, you're so good. You're so good
too. One more time. God, you're so good, yeah.
God, you're so good. God, you're so good. God, you're so good. You're so good.
Bless your name, Lord. We bless your name, Almighty God. We bless your name, Almighty God. You are good. You are good. You are good. You are good. I just feel a need to say, you can be seated. I just feel the need to say that I just want to have a word for somebody, some people, maybe here, maybe watching online, but there's been so much bad going on around you that it's hard for you to see anything good. And God wants you to know that he is right there in the middle of it, and he is good, and he is so good that he promised that he's going to work it. He's going to somehow, even the things that the enemy does, even the things that the enemy brings into your life, even the things that you've brought upon yourself, even the things that other people have done to you, God says he's going to work it all together for your good. Good is going to, good will, goodness is following you. Goodness is following you. You may not see it right there, right now, but the goodness and mercy of God are following you every single day of your life. Believe it. Dare to believe it and receive it in Jesus' name.
Amen, 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 amen. Hallelujah. Hey, thank you, team. What an awesome job. What an awesome job today. I want to welcome Jimmy or Johnny? Johnny. Johnny Zhang. Thanks for being here today. Awesome job. Thanks for playing today, buddy. Great job. Hey, today is Mission Sunday, and we have a church that has a heart, had a heart for missions ever since we began our church. And it's been a blessing to have an impact upon the nations. And we've had some awesome people be our missions pastors over the years. And a few years ago, God brought us Pastor Ann Hunter. Ann, come on up here. Ann. She's done an amazing job for us, taking missions to a higher level and local outreach and all. And it's been amazing what she has done. And we're so happy to have had her as our missions pastor. And she's got an important announcement for us today.
Well, first of all, please excuse my allergies. And I hate that I have to talk to you on such a special day like this. But you know, I'm going to press through it and hope you can hear me clearly. You know, I started to get up this morning and I had this beautiful black outfit and it had some little white on it. And I started to wear it. And then I thought, no, today is going to be a good day. And so I'm going to wear something cheerful and happy. And so, as I share with you this morning, I have served with on the missions pastor, overseeing the outreach pastor for almost 4 years. And I tell you, I can't even tell you how much I have loved it. And but because I have been battling long COVID for a little over a year, going to be good. I feel for the sake of the church and for my health, I must step down. And I want to thank Pastor Joe. I don't know where he is. And Pastor Deb, because they're the ones who invited me to come here to be missions pastor. And I'm so grateful for all the leadership and that have encouraged me, loved me, believed in me, and stood behind me. I'm so grateful, especially for Pastor Mary, not above any of the other leadership, but she has the position of being overseeing pastor of me. She's executive pastor, but she's overseeing pastor of me. And she has battled this battle with me and always been there to encourage me. My husband and I are not going anywhere. This is our home. You are our people. And this, you guys are my tribe. And so we will be here as much as my body can have the energy to get here. And as you know, my husband works 2 Sundays at work, but he's here when he can. I want you to pray for me for the days, and I hope there's no days. I hope I can be here every Sunday. But pray for the days that I am not here. And I have told many people this, many, including my best friends who go to other churches, that as far as I am concerned, Grace is the best church this side of heaven. And the missionaries and outreach leaders, they're like family to me. And that won't stop. You'll just have another leader. And I'm praying that leader takes you to heights that are so high that you will not believe what all you have been able to obtain and accomplish. And I will be praying for that person. I believe with everything in me, I'm going to be healed. I don't care what the doctor tells me, I'm going to be healed. And he has a purpose in this. I believe it with everything in me. There's a purpose. There's a purpose on y'all's end, and there's a purpose on my end. And just as Pastor Joe said, it is all meant for good.
Well, we just want to present these colorful, joyful flowers to Pastor Ann. I believe the Lord is saying sorrow may last for a night, but joy comes in the morning. And your joyful outfit and these joyful flowers are symbolic of what God is going to do in your life. Thank you from the bottom of all of our hearts. She has served with such love and joy in doing what she has done, serving God and serving this church. And we are going to pray for you, and we are believing for your healing. And I'm not going to hand these to you because they weigh a ton. And they're like slipping out of my hand already. They're so heavy. Here, Joe. Here. Have some flowers. He's like, what do I do with these? Oh, you got to do announcements. I'll keep them. Thank you.
Well, we want to pray. Lord, in the name of Jesus, we pray over Ann. We thank you for her and her ministry, the blessings she has been to our church and our missionaries and the kingdom of God. We pray blessings over her and Pat. We pray healing over both of them right now in the name of Jesus. Lord, we stand in the gap for them. We declare that by your stripes they are healed. Lord, touch every cell of their bodies. Heal them and raise them up. God, we ask for total victory in their lives. Bless them. Bless them, bless them, bless them in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen, 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 amen. Hallelujah. Love you. Yes. Thank you so much. I want to remind you of our missionaries that we support, the Burgers, the Broyers, the Dennises, Candy Summers, the Sviantics who were in Ukraine, and the Tituses that we had lunch with this week and from Pakistan. And just want to continue to pray over all of that. And by the way, Candy's right here. She was on our praise team today. Candy is over a Best Way, a ministry in West Africa and Liberia, where they feed how many children now? 1,257 children, and clothe them and educate them. She's going to Liberia in a couple weeks, and the total cost of this trip is over $3,928. And what she still needs is $1,945. So as you give today, you can give to missions, and that goes to all of our missionaries. We want to encourage you to do that on a regular basis. But also, if you want to give to help Candy get to Liberia, she's going over there because the ministry is growing so fast. She's having to hire and train 11 people. I asked them, is this to replace people that quit? She said, no, we are growing. I'm having to train them. So it's a growing, powerful ministry. If you want to give to that, in giving in the drop-down menu, use a special offering, and that will, whatever comes in, will go to Candy and her ministry. Okay, thank you guys so much for your faithfulness in giving. It's a very meaningful, powerful thing to me. I want to thank all of you for being here today, and especially if you're with us for the first time or second time, thank you for coming or coming back. And we have ways to connect with you. There's QR codes in the lobby or connection cards. You can connect any ways. If you're a first-time guest, we ask you to go to our welcome desk out in the lobby for a gift we want to give you, just our way of saying thank you for worshiping with us today. A couple of quick announcements. This Wednesday night, June 29th, it's starting at 6 p.m., we're having a class taught by Tamara Pilon. It's going to be a six-week class on emotionally healthy discipleship, moving from shallow Christianity to deep transformation. Pastor Deb and I ordered our book. I've been reading it. Awesome book, and I've read some of this guy's books before, and we're so excited about this class. And I want to encourage you, you don't have to read the book to come, but it does help you if you want to get it. It's on Amazon. If you can't come to the class, still get the book and read it on your own, Emotionally Healthy Discipleship. Very powerful book about how to help you move into a deeper relationship with Jesus Christ and have deeper transformation in your life. If you need to register, if you're bringing children, register on our app so that we know how many to prepare for. Also, we're having a men's champions gathering, coffee and conversation. Yes. Saturday, July 9th at 8:30, you can register for that on our app. We have several ways to give here. They'll be up on the screen. And thank you if you're here and you want to give also, you can give at the receptacles at the door. Our scripture for today is Proverbs 11, 24 and 25. There's one who scatters, that's somebody who gives, yet they increase more. There's one who withholds more than is right, but it leads to poverty. The generous soul will be made rich, and he who waters will also be watered himself. That's a great promise. So today we're going to pray over our tithes and offerings, over our missionaries. And Lord, we just thank you. Thank you for this service. Thank you for your presence. Thank you for your blessings. Thank you for all you're doing. Thank you for our missionaries, their faithfulness, Lord, to serve you and to reach the nations for you. Lord, I pray you would move on the hearts of every person here as far as giving to mission, and to have a hand in helping translate the Bible and feed children and clothe them and train missionaries, Lord. All the works we're doing around the world and building churches, Lord. Lord, thank you for that. And I pray that you would move on the hearts of people to have a part in that. Thank you for everyone who gives today, Lord. We pray blessings over those who give. Lord, open the windows of heaven and pour out blessing on them, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Hey, but we're going to have one more song, and then Pastor Anthony's preaching today, and I know he's going to be honoring all those who, he's going to be honoring all those who worked in VBS this last week, which was a powerful, powerful group of people, powerful time. Pastor Anthony, I just want to honor you. This guy put in, I don't know how many hours. Yes. Yes. He was up here for 2 weeks in the day, like all day, every day, training our youth, our three-degree students, who were an awesome help in this. I mean, it was awesome, awesome what they did. It just was such a blessing. And Pastor Whitney, I know you're going to honor everybody, but I just wanted to personally, as your pastors and elders, say we love you and appreciate all your hard work. All right, let's stand. We're going to sing one more song before he comes to preach.
Lord, I'm amazed.
is your love for me. Oh, as we sing it, how wide.
Somebody just shabbat the Lord in this place. Come on, give a shout out to God like you love him. Like you know who he is in your life. Man, as you take your seats, are you guys ready for what God has in your life? I've got to make some noise right now for everybody who served at VBS. Somebody make some noise! That's all I have, like 2 weeks. like most of the parents, if you served here, you know why my voice is gone, right? Because I tell the teens, you have to go hard like the whole time. So for 2 weeks, we had camp like Pastor Joe shared, and we also had the opportunity of not only doing our camp, but serving kids. And I want to tell you, those kids had an outstanding time this week. So I just want to honor Pastor Whitney. She went home. She lost one of her cousins, and we're praying for her. So Pastor Whitney, I know you're watching because you sent an email at 7 a.m. this morning for some reason. we don't have a problem with people serving and working around here. We have a problem with them sitting down. Like Pastor Ann, I told her, hey, it's a seasonal thing, but in due season, God has something for you. He's going to continue moving. But let's just give it up for our VBS, our Vacation Bible School. If you could just stand, if you was a part of the administration team, our registration team, if you were a teacher or you were on safety or facilities, if you could stand, we just want to honor you right now. If you're here at this service, come on, come on, come on. Our men, champions who showed up and served and ran our games, our media and our sound, who trained our teens. Thank you so much. We love you guys so much. Couldn't have done it without you. And Pastor Joe, we didn't even burn down the place. It was good. We did well. Will asked me this morning. He said, did a ball hit the light? And he said, because one of the lights were like shining directly on the screen. And I said, probably so. One of the beach balls or something. There was 1 year we broke the stage. It was, I don't know what's going on around here, but I love it when they're rowdy, but we try to keep everything in place. But let's give it up. I've got to give it up for our parents. Make some noise for our parents. Man, let me tell you, as high as gas prices are right now, I don't want to remind you of it before the sermon, so throw that out of your head right now, because I might lose you. You might be praying that you need gas for the ride home, amen. But our parents brought the teens out. every day. And what was crazy about it, you can tell when teens begin to engage what's going on and something's happening. I had a parent tell me that, hey, my kid has always talked about God and shared things, but for some reason she's been talking differently after those weeks. And I said amen to that. So we heard so many testimonies, and our teens, they ran lights, sound, they did everything. They put skits together. It was just an awesome thing to see the fruit of the labor going out. So I'm excited for them and want to take time to honor them and just love you guys so much. I just thank God for what he's doing. So now, are you ready for a missional word this morning? What's amazing is that God began to speak the word during the worship service, because when I heard people saying, you know what, we're free, but we haven't begun to move yet. Maybe we're standing in comfortable places, hearing the phrase of walk out and step out, and your songs of your goodness is running after me. And it made me think about God as the song. It was controversial in the beginning, that God has reckless love. He has a relentless pursuit for us. And I began thinking about that even when I was his foe, in those lyrics, it says, still your love fall from me. So I'm going to ask you again, and this time act like you know Jesus. Are you ready for what God has for you today? You know, I'm praying over this word today. I really see how God wants to minister to the believer and those striving to believe simultaneously through this word. And I want to set the tone that it's not, information is not the goal, but revelation is. And so I'm going to go straight to scripture. And this morning I want to do something that I don't know if I've done here at Grace, but I'm going to go old school on you this morning. So I'm going to ask you to grab your Bible. I'm not going to put all of these scriptures up here on the screen, but I want you to grab your Bible real quick. And I want you to go to the book of Colossians. And when you get there, and if you didn't bring your Bible, I'm going to read this, or this may press into you to put a Bible app on your phone. Here's the challenge. When you have it, say, go Jesus. I'm going to read this to you. It says, since you have been raised to new life with Christ, set your sights on the realities of heaven, where Christ sits in the place of honor at God's right hand. Think about the things of heaven, not the things of earth, for you died to this life. Somebody say, in your real life. And your real life is hidden with Christ in God. And when Christ, who is your life, is revealed to the whole world, you will share in all his glory. It goes on to say, so put to death the sinful earthly things lurking within you. Have nothing to do with sexual immorality, impurity, lust, and evil desires. Don't be greedy, for a greedy person is an idolater, worshiping the things of this world. Because of these sins, the anger of God is coming. You used to do these things when your life was still a part of this world, but now is the time to get rid of anger, rage, malicious behavior, slander, and dirty language. Don't lie to each other, for you have stripped off your old sinful nature and all its wicked deeds. Put on your new nature and be renewed as you learn to know your Creator and become like Him. In this new life, it doesn't matter if you are a Jew or a Gentile, circumcised or uncircumcised, barbaric, uncivilized, slave or free. Christ is all that matters, and he lives in all of us. Somebody say amen. Amen. Did you get that? I want to unpack this right now. I want to get to the context, because I believe it sets up what God wants you to take away today. See, the context of the word here is stating the fact that the day you accepted Christ, you were born again, but you also died. I'm going to let that sink in. You were born again, but you also died. And if you're serious about living this new resurrected life with Christ, act like it, show some signs, and walk it out. It's basically saying the old sinful nature, the old you, the old man, the old woman actually died. And a great responsibility at that time was birthed to continue to put to death the old you, But it would only happen by the power of the Holy Spirit. Get it? To put to death the sinful nature and desires of your old life. It's telling us that by faith and the power of God, you had to consider. When you came into Christ, you had to consider. In other words, you had to think carefully about the fact that you are dead to those things now. Those sinful things in your new life. Because that life I'm talking about, your former life, was shaped by things and feelings instead of by God. We're going somewhere. It's basically telling us that it wasn't long ago that you were doing all these things and not knowing any better, but you know better now. I love it because when it gets to verse 10 and 11, the text proceeds to close by stating, it's basically telling us that every item of your new way of life is now custom made by the Creator with His label on it. It's telling us that all the old fashions are now obsolete. Words like Jewish and non-Jewish, religious and irreligious, insider and outsider, uncivilized, uncouth, slave and free mean nothing. From now on, everyone is defined by Christ because everyone is included in Christ. Now, I want to start by saying it was Christ's resurrecting power that created a brand new you. However, here is where the move has to happen. You would then need, once you accept Christ, or if you are an unbeliever and you're trying to get to the place to accept Him and learn who He can be in your life, you would need to activate something in the new you by the power of God that will allow you to chase faith on a daily basis. See, your desire and to do greater things, to do greater works, as your Father in heaven spoke of, to set your sights on the realities of heaven, seems to encounter a war against your very own will. Meaning that when God makes you brand new, when He actually frees you, sometimes it's hard to move because there is a war against your very own will to be the brand new creature, to be the brand new person that God has created you to be. Somebody just say, walk it out. Throughout the world, I believe when you think of the phrase, walk it out, ask yourself internally, what does this mean to you? This is a burden word, and that's why I had to call Pastor Joe and say, I'm going to preach. And I'm thinking inside my head, this is crazy. It's been like 3 weeks and I've been this week. When am I going to find time? And the Lord reminded me, He said, you never speak anyway. You just open your mouth as a conduit and I speak through you. So I want you to grab this because it's a setup on where we're going in this. Because when you think about that statement, walk it out, throughout the world, there is a call to wholehearted discipleship. That's what Pastor Joe has been preaching on. That's what we're ministering on, discipleship, which is always accompanied by a call to a life of, somebody say, devotion. Now, I want to help you because devotion is a highly concentrated focus on a particular pursuit or purpose. I want you to grab that word, pursuit. See, when you are devoted, you are committed in love. You are loyal to that which you are devoted to. When you are seeking to live a devoted life in Christ, it means that you're committed to living a life of devotion to Christ in pursuit of His purpose. See, when this happens, His character and the spiritual reproduction begins to happen because then His life is reproduced in you. You then begin reaching to not just obtain faith, but you actually get a taste in your mouth and a desire for saving faith. It is different. Saving faith is what leads to salvation, and it includes things like committing your life to God, believing, obeying. It's a Romans 10 and 9 experience of declaring, openly declaring that Jesus is Lord and believing in your heart that God raised him from the dead and you will be saved. It's trusting and it's inviting Jesus into your life. Shall we go forward? See, walking it out in Christ is not just about reading. It's not just about listening or hearing or even proclaiming the word of God, but it's about acting on that word. Somebody shout hallelujah. Now, I want to give you something because application is going to be so important in this. Before we get to that, I want to continue really exposing you to the word of God in this, because if you're going to walk it out, if you're going to walk out your faith in Christ, if you've been freed, if you've been renewed, or you've met Christ, it doesn't stop there, but there is a walk. There's some examples in the Bible that really spoke this loudly, that really stood out to me, and I want to give you the first one. The faith of a centurion. This is a time when Jesus, and let me clarify, these examples are examples of people walking it out in Christ or having a walk of faith, standing on what they believed or what they heard about Christ. They had enough faith to act on it. Get it? Here it is, the faith of the centurion. This is a time when Jesus had entered Capernaum and a centurion came to him asking for help. In the book of Matthew chapter 8, verses 6 through 8, it begins in verse 6, and the centurion said, "Lord," he said, "my servant lies at home paralyzed, suffering terribly." Jesus said to him, "Shall I come and heal him?" Pay attention. The centurion replied, "Lord, I do not deserve to have you come under my roof, but just say the word and my servant will be healed." This is where it became interesting, because let me explain what's happening here. The officer is basically saying, as it's stated in a version of this scripture, he's saying to God, he said, "I don't want to put you through all that trouble. Just give the word and my servant will be fine." He was stating that Jesus' word was enough. So he's sharing that he's going to send the authority of God's word ahead. Now, that's amazing faith, because he's saying, "Lord, you don't even have to come to my house," because obviously he's heard something about God, and he's basically saying, "Just say the word, and my servant will be fine." He's saying, based on the authority of God's word, that healing is going to take place. And then he turns around and he provides an example. The centurion turns around and provides an example of why he believes this way. Here's what he says. In verse 9 and 10, he says, "For I myself am a man under the authority with soldiers under me. I'll tell this one go and he goes, and I'll tell that one come and he comes. I say to my servant, do this, and he does it." When Jesus heard this, it says that he was amazed and said to those following him, "Truly I tell you, I have not found anyone in Israel with such great faith." Now, the amazing thing here is that, first of all, this was a Roman centurion, a captain, a Gentile, often seen as a pagan, exhibiting and manifesting greater faith than Israel. And because of this captain's faith, it resulted in the servant being healed in the same day. Now, Jesus saw the captain as having trust, simple trust, versus the very people in Israel who were supposed to know all about him and how he worked. Now, the mere fact that he had the confidence in the authority of God's word, even as seen as a pagan, as seen as basically not a Jew, as seen as a different person outside of the people in Israel, his confidence in the authority of God's word to send that message of healing ahead was the thing that was amazing. That was the amazing act of faith. But let me give you another example. The woman with the issue of blood. See, I love this story, and I'm going to tell you, it really exposed something different to me when I went back and really read it again, even before this message. Understand, let me help you. The story of the woman that issued the blood, what was going on is Jesus was on a lake
where a large crowd had gathered around him. And the story says that there was a synagogue leader who came out by the name of Jairus. He came and he saw Jesus, and the story says that he fell at his feet. And he was pleading with Jesus, hey, my little girl is dying. Lord, I need you to come save her. I need you to come and heal her so that she can be healed and so that she can live. Now, I know you guys may be looking at me saying, Pastor A, what does that have to do with the woman with the issue of blood? Well, she was in the crowd. I want to help you. In the midst of this, the woman with the issue of blood was actually in the crowd. The scripture tells us a woman in the crowd has suffered for 12 years for constant bleeding. She has suffered a great deal from many doctors, and over the years, she has spent everything she had to pay them. But she hadn't gotten any better. In fact, she had gotten worse. Verse 27 should open your mind, because it says she had heard about Jesus. Come on. Now, she's in the crowd while someone is pleading to Christ. First of all, she's at home. She's sick. She not only walked it out, she probably had to crawl it out to get where she needed to be to Jesus. And you'll see that in the scripture. But I love that it says she heard about Jesus and she began to think in her own thoughts. And she said, for she thought to herself, if I can touch his robe, I will be healed. This was all because of what she heard. We witness people who claim to know Jesus in the world, and when ripple comes upon the waters of their life, they lose all faith. You see, we cannot be only hearers of the word, but doers. We have to, somebody say, move. But I want you to see something, that she just didn't sit back and ponder on what she heard, but she took action so that it shall and it would be done in her own life. Going somewhere with this. So the woman with the issue of blood, think about this. She heard about Jesus, but when she went and made the act, the move of touching his robe, the scripture says in verse 29, the bleeding stopped, and she could feel in her body that she had been healed of her terrible condition. But this is what you have to pay attention to. Verse 30 comes after 29. So Jesus realized in verse 30... that healing power had gone out from him, so he turned around in the crowd and asked, who touched me? Don't miss this, because basically, because of her faith, she had already been healed before Jesus even realized who touched him. This is why we're talking about walk it out. The move, the power of faith right here as a weapon that God given it to us. Because he turns around, he asks, who touched me? And then all of a sudden in 31, you have to see that his disciples is obviously looking at him crazy and like saying, his disciples said to him, look at this crowd pressing around us. All these people, and you're asking who touched you? But he kept on looking around to see who had done it. Then the frightened woman, trembling at the realization of what had happened to her, came and fell at his knees in front of him and told him what she had done. Wait a minute. So according to her faith, she was healed already. He realizes he was touched. It says God felt the healing go from his body. He asked the question, who touched me? She's already healed. It goes to the next verse in 32. When he kept looking, the frightened woman shows up. She shares to Jesus what she had done. And he said to her, daughter, your faith has made you well. What made her well? Sometimes people look and they're waiting for Jesus to come and reach out and touch them instead of them chasing God and having faith so you can obtain the healing that he's already promised you. So sometimes we get free, but we don't move. Sometimes we find ourselves standing still, but I believe that she was healed before he even knew who touched him. So he's saying, your faith has made you well. Your suffering is over. Why? Because of her faith. Now, there was a pursuit that took place within this woman. And because of her walking out her faith, a healing happened. I came to realize that these two individuals were not your normal church attenders, but they were people come on, who heard about God and came up to a conclusion of what he could do. See, this thus a faithful act, trust, it stirred up within them and exposed them to a miraculous healing because they took action. That's why I love seeing Pastor Ann up here, because in the office, I told you, it's just this season. Because your faith, Pastor Ann, your faith in God and what he can do and taking action, I believe you're going to be exposed to a miraculous healing. So somebody just say, walk it out. See, we are to walk by faith and not by what we want to see. See, Paul talked about this a lot, and if you understand anything about the Colossians, two things it says about them, that they were highly disciplined, that they were very disciplined. They really, in their mind, made up their mind how they were going to walk or believe certain things. Paul consistently talked about that principle of how we should live our life, not to just merely attend a church service, not to just attend the church service, worship, believe in Christ, but to walk it out in our daily life. We have to have unwavering faith in a world that is wavering all over the place. An unwavering faith. So regardless of the gas prices, there are shootings, there are so many things going on in the world right now that humanly, we have every reason to be broken or feel low. But that should give believers, that should give us an unction that it's time for us to make some noise. No longer be quiet, no longer receive Jesus Christ for ourselves, but walk it out. How else will we influence a nation if Jesus is all good for you, but you're not walking it out so anybody else can see it? If I'm coming to church and I'm leaving the same way every single week, God was good, Pastor Joe preached, they killed it, but I'm going home and I'm influencing nothing on my job. It doesn't take you to share a scripture, it takes you to walk it out. I said this to the teens, you know what? Are people going to believe more what you say, or they're going to believe more what they see? Because you can say, hey, meet me. My name is Anthony. I'm a great person. I promise you, I'm real good. Like other people will tell you that. But until they see, sometimes we are highly sophisticated, not only in our praise, but in our influence. Because we're living in a world that is sensitive to offenses. I'm glad I got over it. I'm just okay with not being popular. I used to want all the followers and the things like that, and now, yes, you have to say it in love, you have to show that love, but when something is going on, you have to bring influence to that. And I'm just okay if you don't like me. If it's going to save your life, if it's going to allow God to begin to excel you to the next level, if he's going to take you from point A to point B, you have to be in pursuit of his purpose, not your own. Get it? Come on. I want to share this. We have to have unwavering faith. I say it again. In a world that's wavering all over the place, we must be disciplined and actionable in our walk because we have the greatest example ever. Jesus himself, he didn't just sit around talking about why he was sent. Oh, you know, guys, it's going to be awesome. This is why I was sent. You know, he didn't spend a lot of time on that. But what he did, he didn't talk about, hey, this is what I'm going to have to endure. He endured it on our behalf. He gave us the example of walking by faith when he looked beyond the cross. And regardless, he disregarded the shame, right? He disregarded the shame that it would cause him. He would endure and set his focus upon the joy that awaited him. The joy that would happen, right? When he redeemed us, mankind, he walked it out. So here's some resource for application for you to walk this out in your life, because this is about a calling to action. See, one way you can walk it out is that, first of all, you have to begin carrying the attitude of pursuit. You've got to take pursuit. See, pursuit is the act of following something, either to catch it or to engage in a specific activity. See, you have to put following Christ into action. A.W. Tozer said that to have found God and still pursue him is the soul's paradox of love. Come on. That's the whole thing I'm saying today. Maybe he freed you, but you haven't moved yet. You found him, but are you still in pursuit? So you have to move from attending to acting it out so you can truly be following. If you're not pursuing something, are you really following it? We should be following the model of Christ in how he relentlessly pursues us, regardless, even when we were his foe. When we weren't even listening to him, he was still in relentless pursuit. Come on. We should be chasing, trailing. We should be shadowing in full pursuit of our God, not sitting, not just watching, not just talking. We must be active and walk it out, our faith. Look, it's not enough to know him and not make him known. To be in pursuit is to read, study his word, seek him, worship him in good times and the bad, walking out what you know and believe of the promises of God. Can I give you an example? David in the book of Psalms. I want to read this to you because David, I believe this example is just so awesome, because David was speaking to God and he says, "Oh God, you are my God. I earnestly search for you. My soul thirsts for you. My whole body longs for you in this parched and weary land where there is no water." Now understand, this was a time when David was in the wilderness of Judah. He said, "I have seen you in your sanctuary and gazed upon your power and glory." He says, "Your unfailing love is better than life itself. How I praise you. I will praise you as long as I live, lifting up my hands to you in prayer. You satisfy me more than the richest feast. I will praise you with songs of joy." Verse 6 says, "I lie awake thinking of you, meditating on you through the night because you are my helper. I sing for joy in the shadow of your wings." That's amazing that he's saying this in the wilderness. Now, he said, "I cling to you. Your strong right hand holds me securely, but those plotting to destroy me will come to ruin." See, the enemy is going to show up. "They will go down deep into the depths of the earth. They will die by the sword and become food, the food of jackals, but the king will rejoice in God. And all who swear to tell the truth will praise him, while liars will be silenced." I'll leave you with this. Do not think that you have to be perfect before you can pursue Christ. Because if you were perfect, there would be no reason to pursue him. I want you to get that. If you are trying to chase God and become a believer. But point two, I want to share this. If you're going to walk it out, you must refrain from dead works. Proverbs 14 and 12 said, "There is a path before each person that seems right, but it ends in death." Quickly, I want to tell you that we humanly seem to rely on things. Teens heard this during camp. We seem to rely on things that make us feel significant, which are usually things we produced ourselves. Dead works. Anything that is produced yourself that you're going to believe in over Christ, that's dead works. The belief that we can do things ourselves or be good without God is what primarily keeps us from him. We should be seeking spiritual significance over earthly success without God. Doesn't mean you cannot have success on earth, but don't think that's all you need and not God. We have to seek spiritual significance versus our very own earthly pleasure. See, we get focused on what we are doing and making happen that we don't even take time to grow, especially spiritually grow. I taught the teens during camp, I said, sometimes our ego gets too big, and ego meaning edging God out. See, when we begin to think about ourselves, we begin to edge God out of the process of our life. C.S. Lewis said, "Aim at heaven and you get earth thrown in. Aim at earth and you get neither." So the dead works are those things that are self-righteous, those things that we focus on. I want to give you this last example here. There was a story in a leadership book I was reading. Listen to this. There was a professor speaking at a seminar, and I want you to think about dead works, right? The professor is speaking at a seminar with a sports psychologist and asks participants if there was anyone in the audience who couldn't catch a ball. A woman raised her hand, and the sports psychologist took a big soft Nerf ball and said to the woman, "I'm going to throw this ball towards you," and he wanted her to see if she could catch it. Every time he threw it, she bobbled it, and the ball fell to the floor, so she obviously couldn't catch it. Then the psychologist told her, "This time when I throw the ball towards you, don't worry about catching it, but instead focus on the number of times the ball rotates, leaving my hand until it gets to yours." He said, "This time when he threw the ball, she caught it every single time, continuing the number of times she would state the number of times the ball rotated. When she realized what she was doing, amazed, the woman asked, 'Why can't I catch the ball now?' The psychologist stated, 'Because you weren't focused on the results, but you were focused on the process of how many times the ball rotated.'" You see, when we stop being self-righteous, focusing on ourselves and focus on God, believing that His power can do all things in our life, we'll stop focusing on the result and we'll be focusing on the process that He's taking us through. We'll focus on how many times that He's stepping into our lives and what He's doing. The rotation represents that regardless of what's going on around me, regardless that the person is throwing me the ball, she's focusing in on the rotation. There could be people in the room. There could be distractions in your life. There could be so much happening in your life right now that could keep your focus off God. But if you can focus on the process, if you can focus on the rotation, if you can focus on what He's doing, then you will see that His power, only by His power that we can do all things. See, we realize that He is the only way to turn dead things into living things. I want you to get this. Dead people don't serve or worship a living God. You can go ahead and play. I want you to get that. Dead people do not worship or serve a living God. So if you're going to get this, you have to put these two together, because if you have to take pursuit, but you also have to remove yourself from dead works, which means you have to focus on things that will grow you and not consume you. Come on, as I close, focus on things that will grow you and not consume you, because as we seek first the kingdom of God, with all our heart, we grow in Christ because we find Him. But when you find Him, your pursuit does not end there. You have to walk it out. Yeah. See, what's happening right now, the world is in shambles. The world is going crazy. And yes, you need to run to the house of God to refuel, because that's what it's going to take. Because our pursuit, when we leave outside of these doors, there's a mission field. When we leave outside these doors, everyone in this room should multiply. God is not a God of addition. He's a God of multiplication. But if the world is going to change, everyone is going to have to develop the mindset that I'm a world changer because I'm in Christ. I can infect the people around me. But first, I've got to have pursuit within myself. I've got to be able to desire the pursuit, that relentless pursuit of Christ. I'm going to give you an example as you stand to your feet. It's highly easy for Sunday morning to be filled, but Wednesday night to be empty. This is not a promo for Wednesday night. Sunday can be filled, but Bible study, small groups, those things seem to be empty. You know what? No one has time. Go back to the woman trying to catch the ball. See, if I'm going to grow, I have to go to a God who's a living God that turns dead things into living things, right? Because if you know this, that dead things can't exist with God, because He only brings things to life. Everywhere that there was a funeral, there wasn't a funeral anymore when God showed up. Everywhere that there was death, there was a resurrection. Every single time that He stepped into the room, So I'm speaking into your life right now that it is time for us to move. It's time to walk it out. If we don't, guess who's going to suffer? The next generation. They're not going to know. Because there's not enough of the other generation that's bleeding down their influence. There's not enough influence filtering down. So somewhere, the only way my son is going to learn how to change a tire is I got to teach him. So prayer team, come down right now. If you've been standing in a place stuck, if you've been in a place that you didn't feel like you could move, that you have no clarity, if God has been speaking to you and saying he's been calling your name, you can come down right now. Because as we close, we invite you into the house of the Lord. We invite you for breakthrough. We invite you to get to know God if this is your first time. The praise team, they're going to worship. They're going to sing a song. But we are going to continue praying. My youth are in here today. If you're struggling with something, I press into our teams to come to the altar. Because God is calling you right now, not just to know him, but to make him known. In order to do that, you've got to walk it out. Heavenly Father, we just give you honor and we give you glory. We lift up your holy name to the highest level, God, and we believe that you're calling us to action, to move, to walk out our faith as you've called us to. God, and we pray and believe right now that you will show up and you will guide us. You will lift us up, Lord, out of the brokenness. You will lift us up out of the miry clay that we will come like you. Lord, we honor you and we love you. In Jesus' name we pray. Somebody shout hallelujah. Shout amen. We're going to continue worshiping and we're going to continue praying while you're dismissed at this time.
Bring it all to peace. The storm surrounding me, let it break. After your name, you still call the sea to still. Raging me to still. Everywhere. At your name. Sing Jesus.